Hello guys, today I am going to solve the problem is based on the finite element analysis. Okay, so there is an unstepped bar at both the ends are fixed and both the material property are different. One it will be steel and another it is a bronze. So what are the general procedure in the finite elements method? There are 9 steps in which we can solve the any type of a finite element problem is based on a 1D bar element. So what are the steps which will be involved in the final steps? So first steps to make the discretize. So any element we have to discretize. Discretize is nothing but the meshing the elements, or in a simple form we can say the body is going to be converted into an line diagram. Okay, so whatever the element, they may have given 2 elements, 3 elements or in different shape. It may be a truss or it may be a and be any type of problem, we have to discretize the element. Okay, so discretize is the first thing. So how to discretize here? See, the entire element you have to project and draw one straight line. So we have to convert the body diagram into one dimensional element. So here this becomes an one node and it will be 2 node and 3 node at the axis. So there are 3 nodes, node 1, node 2 and node 3. Okay, so just the body which will be projected here. And number of elements, so we have one element that is made with an steel and another element it is a bronze. So there are 2 elements, so I will write in the bracket element 1 and element 2. You better to be keep in the bracket as an element and node should be at the node, nearby node. Okay, and the length of the beam, it is again same as 200 will be the length for the element 1 and 100 millimeter will be the length for the element 2. So both value will in millimeter. Okay, so once if you discretize or converted in a line diagram, again we have to see for the area of cross section, whether the cross sectional area is given in diameter or the direct area of the cross section. So here we have the area for the element 1, that is 1000 millimeter square, and for the element 2 it is 2000 millimeter square. Means area is directly given in the question, so no need of calculating the area. And also the Young's modulus, it is a material property. Okay, so always we have to remember the input value, it should be a material property. So we have to look for the material property, whether both the elements are made with an same material. Sometimes both will be made with an steel, so in that case the Young's modulus it will be same for both the element, that is E1 E2. So in this case we have different material, so the material property it will be changed. Okay, then next one we have to look for the cross section area. Okay, so cross section of the area, I mean generally it will be in the a circular ball, and the cross section you need to be calculate. Therefore area for element 1 it will be pi by 4 d1 square. Okay, if the diameter is given, so you need to calculate the separate area for different cross sections. And also the load acting. Okay, so where the load is acting at the bar. Okay, so here they have given the arrow marks of the load. The point load is acting along the axis towards right side at a node of 2. So this is at a node of 2 where the load is acting. Okay, so that should be considered. So these 3 input you have to first see in our question. Okay, so after that the load is given as 200 here. So the load at 2, it will be 200 kN. It means the P value will be 200. So these 3 will be the input value which you are substituting in the equation. Okay, so after that the output means what to be determined here generally. So first thing, we have to calculate the stiffness matrix. So all these outputs, these will be the outputs: stiffness matrix, global stiffness matrix, and load vector, and displacement at each nodes, and stresses at each element. So these are the output value, we can say. So these three will be the input, and these three will be the output value. And one more, it will be here, fourth one, the boundary condition which you are applying there. So what type of boundary condition which you are going to be applied to the element. Okay, so these are the input and output value. Okay, so once you have identified all these input and output, then we have to follow the steps. So first step, it will be discretizing the element, and second step, that is to calculate the stiffness matrix. So stiffness matrix, so the stiffness matrix, okay, it is defined as where K, stiffness matrix, it will be denoted by K, where K is equal to force per unit deformation. The unit formula for the stiffness matrix, force per unit deformation or displacement. So you can write where K U is equal to F. So this is an universal formula which will be used in the finite element methods in all the units. Generally we can say in all the units this formula will be used, K U is equal to F. Okay, so always you remember. Now after this equation, you are going to calculate the stiffness matrix for each element. So how many elements are there here? There are two elements, so I will write this is an element 1 and this is an element 2. Okay, means the stiffness matrix in the element 1, that will be K1, stiffness matrix in the element 2, that will be K2. Okay, so what is the stiffness matrix for the bar element? So this, for bar it will be different, and for beam it will be different, truss it will be different. So for each unit you will have the different K value, only K value it will be changed. So for a bar element, it is AE by L in the bracket in matrix 1 minus 1 minus 1 1. So this is an general equation for the bar element. So now you are going to calculate for stiffness matrix for element 1. Okay, for L1 it will be K1 is equal to A1 E1 by L1. So what is A1? Element area for the element 1, E1 material property, that is Young's modulus for the element 1, divided by L1, length of the element 1. So similarly you should substitute for the K2 also. Okay, for K2 what is A2? A2 will be divided by L2, A2 E2 divided by L2. What is A2? A2 is given as 2000 into E2 as 83 gigapascal divided by L1. Okay, so always you remember here, it is given in the gigapascal, 200 gigapascal. Okay, but our value is in millimeter square. So you cannot substitute, where 200 into 10 power of 3 newton megapascal. Okay, where giga to be converted into mega. So when megapascal, we can write as 1 newton per millimeter square. So this becomes the standard value. So the total value of the E, 200 into 10 power of 3 newton per millimeter square. Okay, so this is the answer. Now here also same thing, 83 gigapascal to be converted into 10 power of 3 newton per millimeter square. Okay, just you substitute the A2 value and E2 value divided by L, length for the element 2. So once you calculated A1 and A2, we will go for calculating the third steps, that will be the global stiffness matrix. Okay, so we have calculated stiffness matrix for each element. Whatever the value we will get, that will be the stiffness matrix for each element, that is K1 and K2. So once it is calculated, then we will go for calculating the global stiffness matrix. Okay, so the global stiffness matrix, it will be taken as where K is equal to sum of all these stiffness matrices. like K1, K2. We have two elements, so we have added two elements. If you have more elements, then add one more K. Okay. So this is nothing but global stiffness matrix, means adding the all these stiffness matrices. So how to add here? Okay. So there is one methodology in the global stiffness matrix of summation of number of stiffness matrix. Like I will write the value of A1, E1 by L1 in the bracket 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1 plus A2, E2 by L2 again 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. Okay. So here only the value of A1, A2 and L1, L2 will be changed. So after that, what are the deformation which are acting at the element 1? Okay. At the element 1, you can see here the deformation at element 1, that will be a U1. Okay, we'll say U1 will be the deformation. Similarly, at the U2, at node 2 and at 3, it will be U3. Okay, so these are the displacement or deformation, you can say. Okay, so at element 1, it is starting with 1 to 2. Okay, so I will write U1 and U2. And here also U1 and U2. In the row as well as in the column, you need to write U1 and U2. Similarly, for the element 2, it is starting from 2 to 3. Okay, so it will be U2 and U3. U2 and U3. If you have one more element, let us say if you have one more element is connected here. So it is starting from 3 to 4. So here 3 to 4 it will be added. Okay, so here let us take, you have calculated some value for A by E by L1. Okay, so let's keep that value as constant. Plus, and this is another value, let us keep as constant. Okay, so after this, we have to add all the both the values to calculate the K value. Okay, so make a 3 into 3 matrix because the number of nodes are 3. So the final matrix, it will be 3 into 3 matrix. Okay, so in the row, write down U1, U2, U3, and here also U1, U2, U3 in the column also. So now for U1 and U1, so here what will be the value? So you might calculated some value here, so that you can take inside. Okay, so that, and again here also you will have the some value. So now what will be the value at 1 and 1? So here you have 1 and here you have 1. So this is the value for U1. So that value again here, check for the element 2. Here you don't have U1. So you can write this value 1. Okay. So again some value will be there here. Okay. Similarly, for the U1 and U2. U1 and U2, this is the value. So again you don't have value for the U1 here. Okay, so that will be the your value. Again for U1, U3, you don't have that link, you don't have. So here no 1 and here no 1 also, here no 3. So it will be 0. Is it clear? After that, U2, U1. So U2, U1 is nothing but this value. Whatever the value you will get, that you should be right here. Okay, similarly, U2 and U2. So this value, U2 and U2. So U2, U2, you are having this value, that is 1. After that, similarly, you have the another value at here also. Okay, whatever you will get, that should be inside. So that value plus this value means for element 1, 1 value plus 1 value should be added. Whatever the value you will get, that should be added at the 2. Similarly, U2, U3. U2 and U3 is minus 1, that value means this, whatever you are getting, that value should be here. Okay, like that you have to calculate all the 3 into 3 matrices you have to fill. Similarly, U3, U1. So U3, U1 it will be 0 because no link between the 1, 2, 3. And U3, U2. U3, U2, this will be the value. So that value you should be keep here. Similarly, U3, U3. So whatever the value you will get, that should be kept here. Okay, so this is a method for the global stiffness matrix, to calculate the global stiffness matrix, adding 1 and 2 or if you have more number of stiffness matrix. Okay, you have to see the elements 1, 1. So 1, 1, this is the value. Again, you have to look for the element 2 also. If there is a 1, 1, No, so only this value to be added there. Okay, so once it is calculated the global stiffness matrix, so general formula will write A1 E1 by L1 next 1 1 next U1 U2 U3 1 2, so 1 2 it will be A1 E1 by L1, so minus next 1 3, so it will be 0. Now 2 1, so 2 1 it will be minus A1 E1 by L1. 2 2, so 2 2 it means A1 E1 by L1 plus this one again A2 E2 by L2, again U2 U3 U2 U3 it will be minus A2 E2 by L2, again U1 it will be 0, U3, so U3 and U2 it will be minus A2 E2 by L2, again U3, so U2 3 will be A2 E2 by L3. So this is a general procedure we are going to define here, but your answer will be in the form of value, because you know what is A2, what is A1, all the values you have, just you substitute here, then it should be in the numerical. Okay, so once you calculated the global stiffness matrix, then we will go for calculating what will be the global load factor. Okay, so load factor, it is nothing but the force vector. Okay, so now where the force is acting is, the force is acting at the node 2, am I right? But there is no force at the 1 and there is no force at the 3. So the force vector, it will be taken as F. Okay, matrix F, and the it will be in the row form F1, F2, F3. F1, F2, F3 means force acting at the node 1, force acting at the node 2, force acting at the node 3. But we have the force at 2. So I will write F1 as it is, F2 it is as 200 into 10 power of 3, and F3 as it is. No changes. Only substitute the force where it is acting. So we are force at 2. So that is called global load vector. So once you calculate a global load vector, then we will go for calculating the displacement vector. Fourth one, to calculate the displacement. So displacement vector, that is called U. So here force per unit deformation or displacement. So that will be taken as U1, U2, U3. Means the displacement at 1, displacement at 2 and displacement at 3. Okay, so generally here the force is acting, so there is a deformation. Okay, when the force is acting at here, there will be a deformation. We don't have deformation at 1 and we don't have deformation at 3. Why? Why means there is a fixed load, there is a fixed support at 1 and as well as at 3. It means whenever there is a fixed supports, you can take U value as 0. Always remember, directly we can take where, because of 0, when it is fixed. So now U1 will be 0 as well as U3 will be 0 because of fixed supports. Okay, so these two be 0 0. Okay, because of fixed support we have taken as 0. Now you have to calculate just the deformation at 2. That is the next point you are going to calculate, what will be the deformation in the 2. So once you calculated the stiffness matrix K as well as the force vector and the displacement vector, these three are required in the calculating the stiffness matrix in the 1D bar element. These three value you have to constant, how to get these three. First one is K, second one is force, and third one it will be the displacement. Always remember, you need to calculate these three value in the initial steps. Once you calculate it, then we will go for calculating the displacement. So I am just substituting the value in the form of KU is equal to F. So this is a general formula for the stiffness equation. We can write the stiffness equation for the 1D bar element. K U is equal to F. Okay, just write down what is the value of K which you obtained here. Whatever the matrix, that is 3 into 3 matrix, write down, into the displacement matrix 1 into 3, that is 0, U2 and 0, is equal to force, that is F1, F2 is 200 into 10 power of 3, next F3. Okay, just keep the value in the format. So this is a 3 into 3 matrix you are going to obtain. Okay, so once it is made in the formation, then there is an elimination method. Okay, we call it as Gauss elimination method. By using Gauss elimination method, we will eliminate the terms which have been taken from the boundary conditions. Okay, here F1 and F2, it will be taken as 200 into 10 power of 3, and this is F3. Again, similarly, it is U1, U2 and U3. Next, there are three elements which are already calculated, the A1, A2 value. Okay, so this is an U1, U2, U3, U1, U2, U3. So what define, what Gauss elimination defines, whenever there is an displacement is zero, okay, that first row and first column, it will get cancelled. Okay, similarly, for the element 3, means deformation at 3, the third row and third column, it will get cancelled. Okay, clear? When the deformation is zero, this zero we obtain because there is a fixed end, and this U3 we obtain 0 because again there is a fixed end in the another. Okay, so after that, what is the remaining value? These 3 will be the remaining value. Whatever the value here, just write down, there is an one value, into U2 is equal to the force value, that is 200 into 10 power of 3. So you are going to get the value of U2. So that will be in millimeter. Okay, the value of U2 0.075 millimeter as your result. Once you substitute all the values, the calculated value in the box, so you are going to get the U2 value as 0.075 millimeter. So this is a method to calculate the nodal displacement. So we have calculated the nodal displacement. U1 is equal to 0 and U2 as this one and U3 is again 0. So these are the nodal displacement. We can write down at the end of the calculation. Okay, so after that, we need to calculate what is the stress in each element. Okay, so for different material, we will have the different stress. Okay, we have to calculate what is the stress at element 1. So stress, it will be denoted by sigma. Sigma is equal to, what is the formula to calculate here? That is E by L in the bracket minus 1 and 1 into the displacement for the element 1, that is U1 and U2. Displacement for the element 1, 1 to 2. So I have written 1 to 2. Now substitute the value of E1 that we have already taken, Young's modulus in the material 1, that is 200 gigapascal, divided by L1, length for the element 1, into the matrix minus 1 1. So you have to multiply this value inside, then the value of U1 and U2 you need to substitute. U1 it will be taken as 0 and U2 it will be 0.075. Now you make the multiplication by using the matrix methodology, you will get the value of stress that will be in Newton per millimeter square. Okay, the value of this stress, you will get 75.1 Newton per mm square will be the stress for the element 2. Similarly, if you want to calculate the stress in the element 2, that is sigma 2, it will be E2, L2. Okay, again the matrix it will be same, minus 1 into 1, but the value for the deformation it will be changed, that is U2 and U3, because for the element 2 it start with 2 and end with 3, so we have taken U2 and U3. So after that, substitute the value of E2, that is 83 into 10 power of 3 giga Newton per mm square, divided by length, we have taken as 100 millimeter, again the matrix it will be same. Then u2 value, substitute the value of u2, that is 0.075 into here it will be 0. U3 value will be 0. So this is the method to calculate the stress for the element 2. Sigma 2 is equal to E2 by L2 minus 1, 1 again for the stress U2 and U3. So you will get the answer for the sigma 2, that is 62.33. That is in the negative. The stress it will be negative at element 2. Why it will be 1 we will get as positive, this answer it will be positive, that is 75 something you are getting. So here for the element 1 the stress are under tensile, okay. So here it is under tensile, the element 1 the load is acting under tensile, so the stress it will be having positive value. But for the element 2 where the stress is under compression, okay, so its value will be negative, the stress it will be negative. So that value we are going to obtain here, 62.33. So this is the methodology to solve any type of 1D bar element. So this same methodology you can apply for all the formulas. So this is the solution for the given problem. Okay, so thank you for watching.